It's Thursday, December 5th, 2019, and you're listening to the Beer Temple Insider Roundtable. Remember, this is what we said. To never be heard or seen from again, 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 again. Remember, this is what we wanted. Remember, this is what we said. To never be heard or seen from again, 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 again. Hello, and welcome to the Beer Temple Insiders Roundtable. I am the host of the Insiders Roundtable, Chris Quinn, coming to you, as always, from Studio B here at the Co-Prosperity Sphere in beautiful Bridgeport, Chicago. Thank you to Lumpin' Radio for having us on yet again, and thank you to the fearless leaders of Lumpin' Radio, Mr. Logan Bay and Mr. Jamie Trecker. And I'll also say thank you to all the other people who help us out at Lumpin' Radio, such as producer Annie, who's helping us tonight. And as Serge takes a much-needed break after only 1 week back, he already tapped out and said I'm out, but he'll be back. I got him coming back. And thanks to all you guys who are listening on 105.5 FM here in Chicago. That's WLPN, you know, Lumpin' Radio. But if you listen via podcast, thank you for listening there as well. Wherever you listen to your podcasts, thank you for your ears, your share of ear each week. And for those who are listening for the first time, I like to kind of say each week that what this show is about. And essentially this show, the Beer Temple Insiders Roundtable, is me trying to recreate what I love most about the beer industry, which is sitting around with people who I respect and admire, or at least whose opinions I respect and admire to some degree. Maybe the people I may not. Doesn't mean I don't, but it doesn't mean I do. That's all I'm saying, Pat. Just chill out, man.
Yeah, I kind of knew you were talking about me.
Yeah. Well, I mean, just because I was staring at you
without
blinking as I said it doesn't mean I do that every week.
Yeah, I got it.
I like to sit around with people whose opinions I respect and talk about, you know, the subjects that we have, to some degree, built our lives around, whether it's people who are, have brought beer into their life through selling it or making it or writing about it or all sorts of whatever it is, drinking it even. So not even drinking, it's an important part. None of us would be here if people weren't drinking the beer. So and getting us all around a table, so to speak, and talking about this stuff. So that's what this is. This show tries to kind of recreate that experience. And with that, I'll get right to it. It's kind of a slow news week, so we're going to probably stick to the outline pretty closely. I will say we're off to a very typical start, which is people taking selfies of the studio with me in the background, and which I think that is probably the number one way in which I appear on social media, is me in the background of a picture of a selfie in this radio studio.
I did not take a selfie.
You didn't, but you did the other thing.
I did,
thing.
But I cut you out, Chris.
That's fine.
Just so you know.
Okay. Maybe my finger's in there. But no, thank you.
Just trying to build your
I made sure
numbers.
That it, yeah.
All entirely not there. And then the other thing is, it's becoming a tradition now, is that I'm the only one up and looking at the guests at the time where the show's beginning, because everybody else is staring down at their phones. And producer Annie and I were chuckling because I was literally talking to these other guys, but they had their headphones on and had no idea I was actually trying to have a conversation with them or talk to them about something, because they were heads down And we're, you know, doing that social media thing.
Yeah, I was checking life, in man. On the everyone's heard of double barrel bourbon. I'm just checking in on quadruple barrel.
Quadruple barrel. Yeah. So that's a double barreled double. Two different double barrels.
Bro, you
blended?
Can't even wrap your brain around four barrels. I can't. Okay. So anyway, no. I just was honored to try quadruple barrel bourbon county stout. I gave it 17 bottle caps.
Ooh.
So you know what? So step off.
That takes a lot of check-ins just to get that number. Unless it, you had a, you, did you unlock a badge to do that?
Yeah, I unlocked the super duper
capper
goose bourbon county since 1992 badge.
You don't want to sound bitter. Come on now.
They haven't figured out how to not let you have the badge,
right?
Know. I'm not on Untapped.
So let me get to my guest before I do. I have to mention. Maybe, you know, too late, but their opinions are their own only and not the opinions of any other entity that they may be affiliated with, including Lumpin' Radio and any other place. It's just their own opinions, everyone. But we will introduce people in order of seniority, pretty specific, I think, order this week. Mr. Pat Berger, you're definitely the senior member of the panel this week. Welcome.
Thank you.
How are you?
I'm great. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome. What's new with you, man?
You know, just slogging through the holidays. Got through Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
One down, one to go.
Got the curling season in full effect.
Curling season's in full effect. And, you know, party season and busy. It's all good. Yeah.
Good. Well, thanks for coming on. Thanks for taking time out of the holiday slog to come on.
My pleasure. Thanks for asking.
Yeah. you didn't sound super genuine.
No, I know. Well, no. You just asked me yesterday, so.
It's true. You're not supposed to let people in on the
sorry.
Magic.
Oh, third wall. My fault.
Uh-huh.
I thought it was insiders.
Yeah, right. My next guest is Mr. Josh Noel of the Tribune, Chicago Tribune. What's up with you, man?
Oh, busy week.
Yeah.
Busy week in beer writer land.
For sure.
Crazy
man.
Week.
A lot of stuff going on.
A lot of stuff, yeah.
Yeah.
But it's good. The industry is, it never really stopped being interesting, but it's suddenly.
There was a
really
lull for a little bit. I felt like after all the acquisitions, it's like, okay.
Oh, it quieted down, but it's not like it ever stopped getting interesting because there were things,
right.
You know, things are always developing and. You know, people trying to keep up and hazy IPA, we were all wrapping our heads around. And then, you know, pastry stouts and hard seltzer and someone's closing, someone's opening. And now
and
it's
you
just
broke a little story, a local, not a little story, but a local story just today.
Oh, today, yeah. That which
right?
We should talk about probably at some point. I mean, it's a little thing, but I think it speaks to a broader issue.
I would totally agree.
Yeah.
And, well, thanks for coming on, man.
For sure.
Very interested to hear what you have to say about some of the topics that may or may not come up. I don't know. I still haven't decided what I'm going to talk about. But anyway, my final guest for this part, we will probably certainly have somebody crashing the show a little bit later. I'll leave that to your imagination out there, regular listeners, who that may be. But my next guest is Mr. Chris Furnari. How are you? Are you out there, Chris? Calling in, Skyping in.
I am. Can you guys hear me all right?
We can hear you great. Yeah.
Wow,
you're sitting at a computer. I can hear that.
Right. Sorry if you heard me typing. I'm trying to retweet Josh over here.
Ah.
He took a selfie that you mentioned, and I'm not in it. I feel. Yeah.
It's not a.
I feel left out.
I'm really disappointed in you millennials for not knowing what a selfie is.
Because
if the taker of the picture is not in it, then it ain't a selfie.
It's just a picture.
There you go.
Well, you had that little, you forgot your extender, that little thing, your selfie stick. So anyway, how are you, Chris?
I'm doing all right.
Okay.
It's been a busy week, as everybody has already alluded to. I'm a little under the weather. It's been snowing and cold here in the Northeast, so shoveling snow, you know, but I'm hanging in there.
Yeah? Hanging in.
I'm off the beer tonight. I got a, I felt compelled to have a little bit of, you know, alcoholic fuel for this conversation.
Yeah.
So I threw a little Tito's in my Spindrift.
Did you really?
Yeah. It's the original spiked seltzer.
Well, the original spiked seltzer, I think, is a vodka soda. But barring that, I think you're probably right. It's the original spiked seltzer.
DIY spiked seltzer. DIY White Claw.
And the truth is I'm a big Spindrift guy. And the truth is that is a far better hard seltzer than pretty much, I think, anything you can buy in the stores is Spindrift with, I usually do a shot of gin myself. I did actually a fair bit of that this summer. So pro tip, just skip the White Claw and just do the Spindrift and vodka or Spindrift and
gin. How many different spiked seltzers have you tried now, Josh?
Oh, a lot. Too many. A lot.
I mean, you were up to over 40 when I had my first one ever, I think. You were, you know, by that day, you had over 40, and that was months ago. I think since then, I've had maybe zero more.
I get them in the mail now.
People are really
sending me their hard seltzers, and newsflash, they're mostly bad.
Yeah, that's not true. I did have the City Water from Sawmouth. That's the only other one I've ever had. So
I'm proud to say I don't know what Spindrift is.
It's like a LaCroix.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's like good LaCroix.
All right, well.
Or better LaCroix.
It's something. LaCroix with, like, remember Orangina that had, like, those, like, it was shaped like that weird-shaped bottle that was kind of like an orange fizzy drink?
Yeah.
It's kind of like that, but with,
but
like,
but it's alcoholic?
No, it's not.
Oh. Right.
But it has, like, a third of the juice that Orangina. That's how I remember it, anyway. It's just, actual juice.
It has, like, a few calories, and it's, like, you know, made with real fruit, and it's actually colored seltzer. Not hard seltzer. It's good stuff. It's expensive, but it's good.
It tastes like basically what it's meant to taste like rather than an approximation of it like LaCroix.
All right.
Much better said.
So here we are with the Seltzer Insiders Roundtable.
I was hoping we weren't even going to talk about hard seltzers, much less soft ones. But
the Inseltzers Roundtable. Yeah. I didn't invent that. That was sent to me. People have emailed us, written us letters, addressed to the Inseltzers Roundtable, because we apparently talk about it quite a bit. But what do you know? It's kind of a thing. 2019, the year of the seltzer, maybe. Unless 2020 is even more so.
I'm mailing you a letter tomorrow.
Yeah. Well, Pat, what beers, let's get this thing going.
Uh-huh.
What beers have you had lately that you've enjoyed, or what beers are you looking forward to trying?
I'm always happy when the Hopewell rep comes in. I've been digging those beers. I don't know if I've mentioned them on the show before, but
we tried to get Jonathan on the show tonight, but
he was busy. Oh. Love it when Jonathan comes by, and they're always, you know, thoughtful beers. We don't buy them all. You know, and he's one of those guys that isn't upset when I say I don't like something. He's cool about it, you know. I don't have time to
Are some people not cool about it? Do some brewery reps get Oh, you both had this experience.
Hurt feelings.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Does that make you want to do business with them less? I would assume so.
I mean, you know, it's just...
You just kind of roll your eyes.
Yeah, yeah. I don't have time for it, you know. It's just, you know, there's all these beers rolling in, and I say the ones I like and the ones I don't. I mean, most people come to me just to get that feedback, you know, but occasionally one is, you know, I'm maybe not used to someone letting them know what he thinks, and they get a little hurt about it.
Well, that's usually the reality in the nation of 8,000 breweries, right?
What I do is I usually, if it's a distributor rep, I basically say whatever's on my mind about it. If it's a brewery rep, I kind of take the Michael Jackson approach, which is I say the good things, and then if I don't, I just, my lack of saying anything about it is usually an indication that I don't like it. And I say, okay, what else you got? And
that's usually how I do it. Yeah, I don't.
But.
I let them know. But again.
Giving away my secret.
Oh, well, I've been digging their beers. They are, you know, thoughtful beers and very well crafted. Mm. And I'm, you know, every time Jonathan comes in with a batch, I'm excited to taste them.
Nice. I think they've been putting out some really, really cool and fun beers for a little while now. Yeah. I think that
in a crowded field, man.
And they're I think they're starting to stand out with with the buyers, but then also the consumers as well. I think that people are starting to have Hopewell in their repertoire of repeat buys, you know,
for where sure.
It doesn't need to be a new beer every time in order for them to try it. It'll be like, oh, I know that beer and I'm going to buy it because I know it, which I think is a lot harder to come by. And I've noticed that a little bit more with Hopewell lately. So I always think that's a really good sign.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah.
How about you, Mr. Noel?
Oh,
yeah, anything lately? Anything maybe you've written about liking or you had to kind of do contortions to be able to try? No?
Just lager. I don't know. Oh. I'm just sort of into lager.
Oh. You haven't written pretty publicly about not being able to get certain beers lately or anything?
Oh. I'm sorry. I missed what you were laying down there. I was just being sincere.
Thick. Yeah.
Sincerely thick. I did a book reading last night. Oh, you didn't mention my book. You only said the Tribune. I wrote a book, too. I did a book reading last night, and you know, had a pale ale and had a stout, and then it was time to sign the books, and the dude at the store was like, what do you want? I was like, just get me a Pilsner. And he handed me the Pipeworks Pilsner. What's it called? Pipeworks Premium Pilsner or something?
Yes.
Like? Yeah. I'd never had it before, and it was just lovely.
Yeah.
And it was just what I wanted to drink.
Yeah, sounds
beer. I'm in that sort of, I think it's a stage everyone goes through where you just get fatigued from all the other stuff, and you just want some clean, interesting, but, you know, tidy refreshment, and that's where I'm at. So Pilsners. And Helles, and I had a Dunkel from Second Shift, who's in St. Louis, which is just a wonderful.
Yeah,
wonderful
I was there brewery. On Saturday.
You were at the brewery?
Yeah.
For an event or just rolling through?
I'm from St. Louis down there for Thanksgiving.
But you were, you were obviously brewing a collab because that's what you do every
other
day.
That's not true. I wasn't even there very long, but I saw, you know, said hi to the Criders, and he gave me a very nice Kolsch to take with me. That was
In the blue can?
Yeah, in the blue can.
That's a great beer. Yeah.
It's funny, it's a 12-ounce can, and I was kind of like, what is this little thing, man?
Where's
this
the other four?
Are these like 8-ounce cans? He's like, it's a 12-ounce, dude. You just haven't seen one in years.
Yeah, remember these?
Yeah, yeah. So then I guess those are back, 12-ounce cans.
Retro.
Yeah.
Retro, man.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
How about you, Chris? Anything you've had lately that's been exciting?
Yeah, you know, I've been drinking a lot of Lamplighter. I don't know if you guys have heard of them. They're a kind of a smaller operation here in the Boston area. They're actually in Cambridge. But they just landed on the Forbes 30 under 30 list. And I've been digging their beers for a while. And I was pleasantly surprised to see them on there. It was like, you know, super awesome to see one of your local breweries get recognized in that sort of way.
That's cool. And what kind of stuff do they specialize in?
You know, they kind of run the gamut with their beers. They really specialize in, you know, the hoppier styles, New England style IPAs. But they have a good Pilsner as well. They do some Saison, a little bit of sour stuff. They do everything. Their tap room is really awesome. It's sort of like a coffee shop during the day and then, you know, kind of more of a brewery in the afternoon and the evening. They're known primarily for their New England style IPAs, though.
Very cool. Is that what you're drinking now? Or no, that you've had that lately. You're not drinking it now. Now you're drinking a Spindrift with booze.
Doing my Tito's and Spindrift. I did have their Birds of a Feather IPA the other day. I also drank, a beer called Cloud City that was pretty good. I'm a big fan of their Rabbit beer, which is a double IPA.
Whoa, and a total ripoff of a Three Floyds Saison called Rabid Rabbit.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Rabbit, like.
Oh, the word
like,
twice?
The word rabbit twice, yeah.
Oh, pretty similar.
But they got some cool artwork going. Good beer, really good beer. If you make it to this area of the country, you know, check them out. Just drop into their tap room. They're good. They're probably one of the better brewers in the Boston area right now.
Let me ask you, is there some sort of like hometown loyalty in terms of beer drinkers to New England style IPAs? Do they feel like, well, I'm a beer drinker from New England, I got to drink these hazy IPAs?
That's an interesting thought. I think it's more ubiquity than anything else here. It's like you can't really go into a bar that has, you know, any sort of decent selection of craft beer and not see a bunch of New England style IPAs on, even if they're not, you know, sort of described as such on the menu. I go to a bar down the street from my house called Monument, right by the Bunker Hill Monument. And they have a pretty good selection of beers, but it's like, you know, they don't really call out the, I mean, they always have New England styles on. They don't really call it out ever. It's just, you know, they describe the hops also, and the flavor and boom.
That's how it is now. We were joking maybe a month or so ago at our bar that we had to call out that something was a West Coast style IPA now, that it's completely flipped, that you just put, you know, an IPA on there, and maybe, you know, put DDH on there for, you know, the double dry hop to make it very obvious. But other than that, I mean, I think now with customers, you have to tell them if it isn't hazy and cloudy, unless you're in one of Pat's bars, and then it's just assumed that it isn't, I would assume.
We sell whatever they buy, Chris. You know
that. I'll make a comment on that, actually. You know, that's one of the things that I really appreciate about Lamplighter and the way that they talk about their beers on their cans. You know, I was sort of remarking to friends over the Thanksgiving holiday that they can appeal to both the, you know, really geeky craft beer drinker and the sort of, you know, average everyday consumer, because they use language like, you know, DDH, double dry hopped. They use the abbreviation. They talk about the types of hops that are in their beer on the label, and then they say, you know, it tastes like, you know, these three flavors, right? And they really condense it down into a couple sentences. And, you know, the top half of it is, you know, hey, if you're a geek, if you're a geek, you're going to know what Citra and Amarillo and Mosaic and all these, you know, hops are. And if you're not, this is what it's going to taste like. And off you go. And that's it. They keep it simple.
Yeah. Well, thank you for coming on. Much appreciated that you could find some time, even though you're not feeling so great. And I know you have an early day tomorrow, but thank you for calling in. Why don't we, I think I've figured out something we can talk about, but before we do that, why don't we take a quick underwriting break, 60, 90 seconds or so, and then we'll come back with more of the Beer Temple Insiders Roundtable. All right, welcome back to the Beer Temple Insiders Roundtable. I'm your host, Chris Quinn. I'm joined by Chris Furnari and Josh Noel and Pat Berger. And let's get right into it. Huge news. And who wants to set it up, Chris or Josh? Josh, did you? Who broke the story? I guess. Well, did Brewbound break the story, or did you?
Well, I think Constellation broke it.
Yeah, oh, they just did a press release. Boring.
Actually, you know who might have broken it? It was Beer Marketers Insights. They had something up as soon as the press release came out, so they might have had a little leg up. But basically, yeah, Constellation put out a press release and everyone got it at the same time.
Okay. But you talked to the actual fella.
I might have been the first to talk to that guy, yeah.
Why don't you set it up, Josh, if you wouldn't mind? Let everyone know what happened if they've been living under a beer rock
so
past 24 hours, 48 hours.
4 years ago, Ballast Point Brewing of San Diego sold to Constellation, the maker of Corona and Modelo and Pacifico in the U.S., U.S. only. Those brands are owned by Big Bad Anheuser-Busch InBev and the rest of the world. But in the U.S., they're owned by Constellation Brands. And 4 years ago, Constellation Brands thought that it was incumbent on it as a major beer company to buy a craft brewer and turn them into a national brand, sort of like what AB had done with Goose Island.
And AB did that with Goose Island for how much did they do that for?
They bought Goose for $38.8 million in 2011.
11, so 4 years later in 2015.
4 years later, and it was also just a few months after Heineken had bought Lagunitas.
A
50% share for $500 million, so at a $1 billion valuation. And the story is, as Tony McGee of Lagunitas tells it, is that he was he says he left Constellation at the altar. Constellation was going to be buying Lagunitas and had that $1 billion lined up for Lagunitas. And then Tony zigged, as Tony is known to do, and sold to Heineken instead. Anyway, so Ballast Point was, you know, said, oh dear, we've got $1 billion, nothing to do with it, we need a brand. Ballast Point was about to go public, so Constellation gave that $1 billion to Ballast Point of San Diego, which was a much smaller brewery than Lagunitas. And I think everyone who knew anything, this is not revisionist history, I promise you, anyone who had an understanding of the landscape at the time knew that that was a phenomenal overpay for the Ballast Point brand. I don't think anyone,
yeah.
I mean, that would have been a lot for Lagunitas, but it would have made some sense. A much bigger brewery, the number one IPA in the nation, that would have made
it
a lot.
It had a much more national presence. Literally, the Constellation is based here in Chicago.
Yeah.
Their marketing
beer business, yeah.
Their marketing team came into Kaiser the night of the sale.
The bar you own, Kaiser Tiger.
Yes, of Kaiser Tiger. And because my business partner's wife was part of the marketing team. So they all came in, they called me over to the table, and were like, Pat, what can you tell us about this Ballast Point that we bought today? They literally, their marketing team had never
bad
heard
sign.
Of them.
Yeah.
It's a really bad sign.
The thing was doomed in so many ways. And it was, again, not revisionist history. The
that
yutz
might be a little bit.
Sitting on his couch at home, meaning me, knew that it was just a horrible, horrendous overpay.
You know, certainly anyone in the business knew.
It was an overpay.
Yeah.
But I don't think everyone knew that what it was eventually happened was going to happen.
No, but there were warning signs. Like, a lot of Ballast Point's value or perceived value was in the fact that they were charging, what, $14.99 for six packs of Sculpin at the time? Chris Furnari, you got to drink that away from the microphone, brother.
Sorry.
It's okay. It sounds delicious, though. I will give you that. And I think everyone knew that $14.99 IPA six packs were not sustainable and not a way to build a business for the future. I mean, Ballast Point did it to that point, and it was brilliant. I mean, they carved out a truly niche craft. I got air quotes going here. Boutique thing, but the thought that could be scaled, $14.99 six packs, was lunacy. Anyway,
I think the scaled is the key part, because there's a lot of people who are doing, you know, $14.99 four packs,
right? But of, you know, smaller,
yeah, scale, yeah, scale, scale is what I'm saying. Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Anyway, so the Ballast Point brand predictably suffered horrendously under Constellation's ownership. They were, I believe, at their peak. Chris Furnari might know off the top of his head. At their peak, they were making about 430,000 barrels of beer a year. Does that sound right?
Oh, wow. They're making that much. Wow.
Yeah, I think that was the year after that Constellation bought them. They peaked at 430.
So that was like a pipe fill year, it sounds like.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And this year, they're on pace to brew 200,000. So that, from 430 to 200, that is brutal. And they had to close several locations. It's been a rough few years, and so everyone knew that the Constellation Ballast Point experience was not going well and was going to be ending eventually in some form or fashion. I don't think there was no real chatter about where the Ballast Point brand was going to end up, I don't think.
Was there chatter that it was going somewhere?
I thought Marzs was going to buy them for sure.
I mean,
that would have been just as likely as what happened. So,
right?
Where's
Edmar anyway?
Right.
Come on, we got to hear about how he left it on the table.
What happened is that on Wednesday at about 4 o'clock or so, a press release shows up in the mail saying that Ballast Point, this iconic San Diego brand, struggling, yes, but still an iconic San Diego brand, had been sold to Kings and Convicts, a brewery in Chicago that basically suburban Chicago in Highwood, that no one in Chicago had basically heard of.
I'd heard of them, but I'd only heard of them as like this suburban brewery that apparently gets kind of crowded. That's literally the only thing I'd ever heard about them.
I didn't even know the gets kind of crowded part.
I heard that they were doing like pretty well, and they were near the Metro Line or something like that.
Yeah, that would make sense.
Yeah, and You've never
had their beer in your store. No one's ever brought the beer in for you?
No, I've never tasted it. I had heard of them just because
There's an Australian bar.
Yes,
I'd like Montrose that has had it apparently.
Sure,
the owner is Australian. Aussie, yeah.
And I knew that, and I liked the name. Thought it's kind of funny, Kings and Convicts. But no, I'd never had their beer.
Yeah, so it was the ultimate out of left field brewery sale to happen since the era of brewery
and there's
M&A
no hyperbole
began
in that.
And
that
in
is
earnest.
The ultimate out of left field.
It's so crazy.
It was
man.
So out of left field. So it was stunning. And
let's leave it before a little bit more information came to light after that. But I want to get everyone's reaction to first hearing the news on Wednesday that Kings and Convicts had bought Ballast Point, had acquired Ballast Point. Chris Furnari, what did you think when you read that?
Well, I think the easiest way to sum it up is somebody had sent me a text like right when the press release crossed the wire. And they said, "Who is Kings and Convicts?" And I said, "Is that supposed to mean something to me?" Like, I didn't even know what the question was referring to.
Right.
There was no context for what Kings and Convicts was. So
I had the exact same experience. Someone in the industry emailed me and said, "What's up with Kings and Convicts?" And I wrote back, because they're building an ambitious large brewery in southern Wisconsin. And I wrote back, "Are you talking about the southern Wisconsin thing? Because that news is almost a year old. I didn't even know yet." And then I saw the press release about a minute later. So it sounds like you had a similar experience there, Chris.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. And it was, like you said, out of left field. But it was also like, somebody sees it and then fires off a text or fires off an email and says, what's up with this Kings and Convicts? And you're like, what even is that? Like, that's never even come across my radar. There's, close to 8,000 breweries in this country
right
now. Nobody could possibly know every single name.
I was one of the few people that probably did know both breweries, and not relatively few. And someone said Kings and Convicts just bought Ballast Point. And my reply was, I'll try to get the tone right. What? Just like I had the same reaction as both of you, but did have context. It was like I knew what the full thought was, and I still did not comprehend what that could possibly mean. That, yeah, I know like what that literally means, but that doesn't parse. That doesn't make any sense.
I'm familiar with. I've met the Kings and Convicts guy. I was actually at Pipeworks couple years ago working on something, and that guy walked in with his brand new beer and was super excited to be there and was picking the Pipeworks guys' brains. And I just looked up my response to the guy who had emailed me when I saw the press release. I wrote back to him this, which sums it up, all caps, holy what the F. That sums it up. It just, and someone said that it read like an April Fool's joke. So,
yeah,
you know,
I mean, the first thing
put jokey press releases out on April Fool's Day. It read like one of those.
First thing I
literally
did was Google it. I saw it on my feed or something, and I was like, no, that's not. So I Googled it to, make sure it was real, and it's.
Yeah,
if there was a bigger manifestation of the burst bubble, I don't know what it would be.
Yeah, what are you saying, Chris?
So I don't think it's not crazy that Ballast Point sold. I think what's making this one particularly bewildering is that it's the buyer that everyone's like, well, how could it possibly be that a brewery that made 600 barrels of beer is buying, this 200,000 barrel brewery that at one point made 430,000 barrels that was owned by the third largest beer company in the U.S. Like, that's the part that doesn't make sense, but If you kind of strip away that, it's like if Constellation sells it to, like BrewDog or something, like, oh, okay. It's not even that crazy of a story, right?
Right. Yeah, no, there were scenarios where it would have computed in the moment.
And but you bring up a good point, Chris. There was just things that didn't make sense. Part of it being the fact that, you know, last year they made 500 barrels of beer, Kings and Convicts.
Come on, 600. Don't
shortchange. I thought that was this year. I'm talking about last year.
Oh.
They made 500 barrels of beer last year. And how just what? And what everyone was talking about was how low could Ballast Point have possibly sold for? But then a little bit more information came to light based, I think, on some of your reporting, right, Josh? Which was
So the challenge in the moment was, so as soon as the press release came out, another press release arrived from, I'm not even sure who it was. I guess it was a guy doing PR for Kings and Convicts. And he wrote back, "Here's the news. Let me know if you have any questions." And I wrote back to him, I have so many questions. And he wrote back, and I appreciate that. Like, the Kings and Convicts guy has been great to deal with, honestly. His PR guy wrote back immediately and said, okay, his name is Brendan Waters, Australian fella. Wrote back immediately, "Here's Brendan's cell, give him a call." And I did. And, you know, usually I have a degree of, try to have a degree of professionalism and, like, you know, being in control of the situation. And I just said to Brendan, I was like, what the hell's going on, man? And Brendan rolled with it. And he was like, yeah, I'm not even sure either, mate. I know that was not even an Australian accent. And we just sort of talked it through. And the challenge in the moment was trying to understand how it happened and why it happened. And eventually I said to him, you know, how are you able to finance this? Did you take on new investors to pull this off? And that was sort of the aha.
Right.
So he said, yeah, we recruited, I don't, you know, it probably wasn't this simple. You sort of have to pull this stuff out of people sometimes. But basically he acknowledged that the investor group had grown from 4 people to 6 people and that the deal wouldn't have been possible without the other 2 people. So, okay, clearly there is some money brought into the equation. And so these Kings and Convicts guys with a couple deep-pocketed fellas bought this distressed asset. And then it started to make sense. But he wouldn't identify the new investors were. But then the next day, I took another run at him, and then I got it the next day. And so it turns out it's a hot shot in the wine industry, a Californian who's probably very familiar, or who is, Brendan said, he's very familiar with the Ballast Point brand. He has, you know, affection for it and admiration for it. And I guess Brendan convinced him that there's upside here. This is, we can buy low. We don't know the price. It wasn't released. But it was, you guys want to guess? I mean, it seems like the guesses are sort of hovering around like 100 million.
70 to 80.
And that makes all the sense in the world.
Wow.
Do you have that reported, Chris, or are you just guessing?
I have folks who are telling me that's what they're hearing. And these are people who generally are correct on this stuff.
Okay.
And that are pretty well placed.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense, I would say. And it's, you know, there's a lot of people with a lot of money, and raising $75 million, if you know the right people, is a lot easier than, let's say, raising $1 billion, right? So it sort of adds up, especially when you're talking about one of the biggest wine industry magnates in the country, you know?
Yeah, the guy behind Cupcake, right?
Exactly, yeah. Mm-hmm. They own huge wine brands.
Your question to him was, what did you say, how the hell are you doing this, or something
like that? Something like
that, yeah. Yeah, my first question to him when I spoke to him was, who the hell are you?
And he laughed at it, right?
I assume, yeah. I mean,
he seems like a decent guy.
He's a great guy to chat with. But, you know, the other thing that really struck me in my conversation with him was how optimistic he seems about the future prospects, not only for craft beer, but for the Ballast Point brand. And I'm like, you know, that is so contrarian. Like there's a dark cloud over the entire beer category right now, because beer volumes are down and seltzer's taking away customers, and there's all these breweries and everybody's fighting for the same sliver of a small pie, and, you know, all this stuff that we hear all the time, right? And he's like, yeah, you know, if you start to really dig into the numbers, and we spent six months really examining the space before this opportunity came around, and you know what it would look like if they made a big push in the craft space, because they were just trying to have, you know, sort of a professional hobby at one point, it sounded like. And he said, you know, if you kind of peel back the layers, there is still opportunity. And I was almost even more surprised at the fact that there's still people out there who are as optimistic as he is.
One thing that he seems to envision for the brand, which I think is smart. So Ballast Point is distributed, he said, in 49 states, everywhere but West Virginia. And okay. I said, are you going to pull back Green Flash style? So Green Flash was in 35, 45 states, something like that, and they're back down to 8 or something like that. He spoke carefully. He said, well, we have, you know, distributor contracts in all those states, and we will honor them. But he said, we're going to focus on our core markets, which are California, of course, Washington State, Illinois, because they have a brew pub here in Chicago. And I think
they're owned by a company.
They were, and they are again. And I think that he mentioned one other place, maybe D.C. or something. I don't remember.
I think he said Wisconsin. He told me there are like 12 key markets for them, or 12 key states.
Okay.
What was your reaction
I think that approach could make some sense. I mean, Ballast Point still has probably some... Well, it doesn't have any energy behind it, but it has some nostalgia behind it. Sculpin is still a historically great and important IPA, and if I haven't had one in 3 years probably, which is probably a lot of the problem, if they can get people like us and probably the people listening, I'm guessing most of us haven't had a Sculpin in a long time.
I was going to bring one tonight, but I couldn't because we don't carry any
which
of any
volume.
Ballast Point.
So if none. So he's talking about building up the sales force. If they do in fact do that, and they put someone who's got, you know, a brain between their ears in front of you with some samples and is able to talk to you in the right way, and you taste that beer and you get behind it, and then your customers get behind it, I think it's possible. I think, you know, the 49 state we're going to be a big craft beer model is justifiably dead. But a more boutique approach, considering the legacy of that brand and especially Sculpin, I could see it.
Chris, would you give me, would you divulge your thoughts on the optimistic outlook of the owner of Kings and Convicts and now Ballast Point?
Whether I think it's misguided or not, or unbridled, or I don't know. Let's see. If I start to kind of peel back the layers, there's so many interesting things that are happening in the beer space right now. And outside of it, quite frankly, that will probably have some marginal impact on how things play out over time. But just thinking about beer, you have companies laying people off. Look at like Molson, or most recently Brooklyn restructuring their sales team. You have consolidation and M&A activity heating up again. You have this hard seltzer thing that everybody is debating whether or not it's a fad or not. And you have over 11,000 permitted breweries now in the United States. Some of those, obviously, you know, those are federal brewing permits that have been issued, so some of them aren't open yet, right? But point remains, like, if there's 11,000 places that are, you know, capable of making beer, a lot of them are taproom oriented. There's just so much noise and so much confusion in the space that I find it really difficult to be optimistic right now, particularly when beer volumes or U.S. beer production is at the lowest point that it's ever been. Consumer habits are changing. It's impossible to predict what a consumer wants to drink, when they want to drink it. So I don't know. I mean,
yeah, confusing is a good word. Yeah,
if it were me, I wouldn't be as optimistic. But then again, I don't have a wine magnate giving me, you know, $50 million or whatever he pitched in. to buy a brewery.
Right. Yeah, it's I kind of feel the same way. It's been everybody seems so unsure. But no, there are people who make a killing when they see the light and nobody else does. I mean, that's when people do make the killing. Is this that one?
You two are positioned to answer the question better than anyone, the two bar owners. Could you foresee putting Ballast Point on your taps in the next 6 months to a year?
6 months to a year?
Just, you know, giving it time for the deal to close, them to build up their sales staff, get the beer tasting good.
Well, let's ask that question a different way.
It's possible.
Let's ask that question a different way. What would need to happen for you to put that beer back on?
I think it's a better question.
I think it's slightly irrelevant because, you know, Chris and I own very specialized beer bars. I don't think places like ours are ever going back to a Ballast Point. And, you know, I don't know about your bar, Chris. Obviously, you don't carry it, as you just said. But, we kind of moved on from Ballast Point a while back, right? So, what I think this deal kind of illustrates.
But I don't carry it in my bottle shop, even.
Like, right. Right,
which is a lot different than because no one's going to buy it. Bar.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean we're a different animal. Then
SKUs,
we're not Dom. You know, we're not the grocery store. We're not the 7-Eleven. So, but what this deal kind of signifies to me is that craft beer has become, like many other things, a permanent genre of product that goes in and out of favor. And like grandpa beer, you know, now there's craft beer. And these guys are looking at it like, well, this was a brand that was once mighty and we can get it for what it sounds like, 8 cents on the dollar or something. I'm not a math major. And they're going, you know, we can revitalize this. I mean, they do it with like brawny paper towels. They do it with all these like old nostalgia brands and all of that. That's what craft beer is now. So it's just another category that is being invested in and monetized by the big players, and you know, whatever.
Yeah,
that's a crazy thought to think that Ballast Point is a nostalgia brand now,
or that's where it value lies, perhaps.
But that's where it's. I'm not saying, and these guys have a 10-year road ahead of them. You know, and they, what do they care? Probably they got it for 8 cents on the dollar. So they can just hold on to it, wait until the people who grew up on Ballast Point get nostalgic about it and they can sell a bunch of it and maybe build it up, maybe sell it to someone else, maybe just, you know, keep it around as an earner. You know, that's, that's how I see it.
Yeah. Go on.
All the mid 30-year-old folks, in my cohort, we need to get to our mid 40s again, where we have that.
Or our kids might go, "Oh, I remember my dad drinking that beer."
Right, but not really remembering anything other than as little kids seeing the can.
Or my grandpa loved that beer.
Right. Yeah.
I remember my grandpa talking about Sculpin. You know, it's just a brand now.
Who knows, man? I mean, perhaps that's.
I think that's a cheap.
Value.
I mean, if they really got it that cheap, you know,
they're right good for them.
They don't have to turn that around this year.
No,
no, they hold on to that for a while.
So, I mean, to answer the question, what would it take for me to bring it in? It would take an earnest sales pitch that sold me. And an exceptional product. Like, these guys are, this is a world-class beer, and I believe what this guy was selling me. And then I'd bring it in.
Well, we were talking off air, I think.
And that's what
off,
it used to be. Off air. It used to be world-class.
About how few West Coast IPAs there are now, and in some cases, how difficult it is for breweries to make them well at this point because they're not used to making them. That they might be able to stake out that territory.
I'll tell you one thing: these guys did,
and that's what I want. I'm way past the haze.
One thing these guys did was catapult their brand, Kings and Convicts.
Yeah. Oh yeah,
didn't they?
Yes, they
I mean,
certainly
like,
did.
We all have heard of them now. They crashed their website, so you know, some people pay for a Super Bowl commercial. These guys, maybe
people buy.
Maybe they're selling more Kings and Convicts in 5 years than they are Ballast Point. I don't know.
That's an interesting thought.
That is an interesting
thought. We all know it now.
But those two brands are going to be joined at the hip. So they're building this massive Kings and Convicts brewery in southern Wisconsin, and they're going to be brewing Ballast Point there. That's going to be like, you know, what Lagunitas' Chicago brewery is.
Yeah, just what Ballast Point needs. More capacity.
let me throw one other thing out. I talked to I'm doing an interview with the public radio station in LA about this tomorrow. So we did the pre-interview today, and the woman, the producer who pre-interviewed me, is in LA, and she's like, you know, I keep reading that Ballast Point has had a hard time, but I still see them everywhere in Southern California, which makes me think that, you know, if they really are, if that is sort of the breadbasket of that brand, then, I mean, that was really, frankly, surprising to hear. But if that is true, let's hear from you, L.A. listeners, San Diego listeners.
Right.
Then maybe the brand isn't poorly off there right now. I don't know.
There's so many things that could happen. I mean, there would be crazier things than them selling that giant facility out in San Diego, because they still have two other significant well, they have one little homebrew shop, then they have another brewery, and then they have a giant brewery out there.
Well, apparently one of the breweries is being kept by Constellation, is that right?
Yeah, they're keeping the big production brewery in Virginia.
Okay.
Well, and what are they going to make there is what I'm wondering.
Well, what I was going to say with the big one in San Diego, like the Kings and Convicts, especially if they have this big one in Wisconsin coming online, they could like sell to Mark Anthony. Be like, hey, make all the white claw you want.
Yeah.
Here, go for it. You have capacity issues? Here you go. Just give us a contract so we can make Sculpin out of it whenever we need to, or something like that. I mean, there's a million different ways they
can
try to
recoup. There's
some
value there. Yeah, absolutely. And the brand has value. And, you know, that brand is not going anywhere, and it'll, you know.
But on the flip side of things, I think the difficult stuff, I was talking to somebody about, just can you imagine the brain drain that's going to be going on from Ballast Point?
Because I think that I feel like that happened after the first sale.
Yeah, I was going to say, place is already a shell of itself.
It was very unusual that they didn't make those original owners stay on for five years.
Yeah,
that was
a miss. Yeah.
Yeah, that was a big miss in my opinion. And I, you know, I'm not an expert on these things, just a restaurateur.
Well,
it should have been in their contract, though, that they were like contractually
after like 6 months
obligated to stay there for five. I mean,
they walked and sold Cutwater spirits to AB for.
But did they not? Did they have to give up some of the purchase price, or, you know, was there a penalty for that? I don't know.
I would imagine there was some kind of penalty. That's pure speculation, but yeah, I think they probably left something to say, screw it, we're out.
They only walked with $850 million, so you know what? Let's pour one out for the Ballast Point founders.
Those guys are on their private island right now, not listening to this podcast.
And then they sold
the
spirits business. I mean,
I know those guys. Smart guys. Those we should be asking what's going to happen. But in terms of like brain drain, I mean, nobody wants to be embarrassed of where they work, and right now I think Ballast Point is a bit of a laughing stock, I think.
Is it?
I think it is. I think people are not talking about this and looking at Ballast Point in any sort of positive or respectful light. It's all the, oh my gosh, like what a joke this brewery has become.
But isn't that really due to Constellation, ultimately?
Does it matter? I mean, does it matter to the rep? Does it matter to the shift brewer? Yeah. Does it matter to those people? They want out because they want to be able to hold their heads high and say, I sell this, you know, beer or whatever it is for a living. And I think right now, I'm guessing morale is.
Well, those people all got fired.
Solo.
Those people all got laid off by Constellation. They don't have anybody Salesforce-wise. I think if you're talking brewery-wise, you know, possibly. They are the physical manifestation of the bubble bursting, in my opinion. This is, you know, they're the example of
I think this is the broader lessons is something we should dive into. Do we need to?
No. Yeah, you know what? Now's a good time.
Okay.
We'll say it. You're listening to 105.5 FM, WLPN LP, Lumpen Radio, Chicago. What were you saying, Mr. Noel?
I was saying I think a good next level of this chat would be what are sort of the broader lessons here. And I would disagree with Pat that it is the bubble bursting. I would say it is a bubble bursting, and one, it feels to me that the bubbles that burst don't necessarily speak a lot about the overall industry. They speak about individual companies. And for the reasons discussed earlier, I think there was a lot of room for ballast point to for this all to happen. Sort of a perfect storm of Constellation's overpay and what they thought they were getting and their goal for the brand and sort of their misreading of the market, their misunderstanding about the nature of $15 six packs.
Misreading of the market. So you're talking about one of the biggest beer companies in the world misreading something that they bought 4 years ago for $1 billion, and now people are saying it was $75 million. So it lost $925 million in value in 4 years.
Well, they had already taken about $200 million in impairment charges on the brand, so they had already said that they overpaid by that amount, and they were presumably prepared to, you know, take more impairment charges, right?
Yeah. But I guess is what I'm saying is, how did such a successful, a company that was so successful at selling beer, get this so terribly wrong? Does that also mean that, did Heineken also get it really, really wrong too? Is Lagunitas not a billion-dollar brand? I mean,
well, Lagunitas isn't making less than half the beer that it was. I don't have the numbers in front of me, but, you know.
It's about flat.
Yeah, I've heard it's...
And flat is basically a victory these days.
Yeah,
you know?
It is. Right.
But my ultimate point is that I think this says more about Constellation than it says about craft beer.
But when I'm talking about a bubble bursting, you're saying flat is good. I'm wrong?
Yeah, it's fair.
Well, wouldn't it have to be in decline? One of the other things too.
Well, most of them are.
Yeah, but they're still.
I think
you know,
he's saying is if flat's winning.
No, that,
you know,
that,
if you're winning
that,
by
that's
being
a fair
flat.
Point. But there's also 8,000 breweries and more opening. You know, where it's record numbers opening every
year. Yeah, that's part of the bubble.
And this, but. Yeah, no, it could be. But the small ones that are well capitalized and make a good product are healthy.
I'm not saying it's
are healthy,
but
businesses doing well. And I think
I don't
think
Pat's saying there's no market for craft
beer. No, not at all. Not at all. I'm just saying that it's a rarity that a brewery is growing, not a trend, not the norm. And that is
I'd say probably more breweries are growing than not, but they're tiny.
Yeah, you just don't hear about them.
Maybe.
That's a good point.
Right.
They're growing, but the
like
overall
Hopewell's
trend.
Hopewell's okay. Growing. You know?
Yeah,
but
sure. Maplewood is growing.
How many Maplewoods does it take? So Maplewood is kind of like the growth success of one of the largest beer markets in the country. That is the success. Their growth is a drop in the bucket compared to Ballast Point going from 400,000 to 200,000, which itself is a drop in the bucket
right.
compared to a lot of other things.
Yeah. Or Revolution being down. Or Lagunitas, which I think is down a couple percentage points.
I mean, it's hard to be.
Or
a
Sierra Nevada being down, you know?
No, Sierra Nevada,
they're
I think,
up.
Is up.
They're
yeah.
up.
For
they
the
were,
first time in how many years?
Yeah, no, yeah, a long yeah, time. Yeah, yeah. But this is just, we're just sort of echoing.
They're
the
not
point
up
that
from their top number, they're up from last year.
Correct, but you know they've got a thriving brand now in that hazy little thing, which
yeah,
I think
yeah,
is
yeah, yeah, yeah. Everyone's
okay.
yeah.
And
they're one of the they're maybe the best brewery in the country.
It's not news that it's tough to be a brewery bigger than 50,000
right.
barrels.
Well, then let's
and
all
most
say
of the,
breweries the bubble
are
burst.
Far,
maybe
far smaller than that.
Maybe then the bubble did burst.
Well, maybe you know, we might need a better way to talk about it than the bubble burst. I mean, what does that even mean?
Well, I don't know. I don't work for the BA. I don't have to like filter my way of talking about it. You know, I don't.
Well,
what
no,
do
then
you
explain.
Mean?
What does that
about,
mean?
Yeah,
the bubble burst.
What does that mean to you, Pat?
It means that you know there are less growth going on in the industry than it means it's. It's
craft
done. Craft beer is just kind of, it's
3%.
Been this thing. It was great. It's permanent. But now it's, you know, peaked and going down. That's what it means to me. I'm just a restaurateur. I'm not an economist. I don't know how all this works. but
we're about to settle this.
Some excuse, Pat.
Some excuse.
I'm not an economist, huh?
Save me, Edmar. Save me.
I'm not an economist. That's that's not true.
It's absolutely true.
I heard about Pat Berger. I was reading The Economist, and I saw an article written by him.
And I looked up, and Pat was there.
Yeah, Pat was,
and there it was.
Yeah. And Pat was reading the same magazine.
Yeah. So
I don't know. I think everyone's tiptoeing around it.
I will say, in terms of bubble bursts and so on and so forth, I know at, like, maybe it was it, Chris, you would definitely know this better than me, or remember it better than me. That what year was it at the CBC where, like, valuations was, like, all you heard people talking about, even on, like, the trade show floor and at all the conferences? Was that, like, 3 years ago, 2 years ago? It was not long ago.
Probably right after the Ballast Point sale. I mean, that was irrational exuberance. That was an irrational bubble.
I think it was the Portland, Oregon CBC. So whatever year Portland, Oregon was, because that was
2014,
every single conversation I had there. Yeah.
Didn't I meet you there and I made fun of you in, like, some sort of, like, I don't know, some...
Likely.
I forgot where it was, in, like, the conference hall. You're hanging out with someone from a big sale brewery or something
like that. We can figure that out later, Ed.
Yeah.
You're not the first person and you won't be the last person to make fun of me. I'll say that much.
I do think that based on what I heard at CBC this previous year, morale and outlook is definitely in a very different place right now. I think right now it's survival mode if you're anything other than a tiny upstart. And the long tail is where the story is at, and the BA is being very upfront about saying that that's where growth is going to be, and that zero growth via distribution is the new normal, and this is not an anomaly, and this is how it's going to be, and pushing people towards smaller own premise, more high profitability. Not high profitability, but higher margin.
Keeping the profits.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, there's... I think there are still pockets of the country and business models that are going to be successful, and opportunities that exist for certain types of companies. But by and large, there's a couple points that I'd want to make on that sort of topic, which is... and we've been talking about this for a long time, I feel like, in the industry, where there's these companies that are sort of caught in the middle. You know, they've scaled to a certain point. They're not big enough to really matter to the bottom line of a distributor, but they're too big to, you know, self-distribute their brands in any sort of scale, right? You know, in chain retail, what have you. So they have to go through the three-tier system, and it's tough. It's really tough for those breweries. So I think those are the ones that are the most challenged. And, you know, the other sort of thing that I've come to realize over the last couple of months that I just find interesting, and I don't know what the answer is to this, but, you know, for years, what made craft beer really, really special and really awesome, you know, back in the day, you know, when I first got into it in, 2009, 2010, mm-hmm. you could walk into a chain grocery store and find all these wonderful beers and really explore. And every few months, there was a new Dogfish Head. Now, granted, there's, you know, far fewer breweries, right? But there was a new Dogfish Head beer. There was a new whatever beer. And you were trying. You were exploring. Now the distributors are saying, we have so many brands and we have so many SKUs, you really need to rein it in, and you need to give us two or three brands to focus on, and those are the ones that we're going to sell. And we might be able to take on a couple seasonals here and there, but, you know, we don't want to do, you know, much more than a few brands for every brewery. So if you're an average, you know, mainstream, you know, Joe Sixpack, how do you go explore at the chain retail level when distributors are limiting the amount of exploration opportunity there is because of the way that they want to operate? They want to be more efficient. That's something that I'm wrestling with.
Craft- Entirely true. And at the same time, Chris, I think the opposite's happening at the enthusiast hobbyist level, where exploration has been gamed. It's been gamed, where now every week a brewery is putting out a new beer every week because they know if it's new, there's people who are going to try it because it's new. And now you're just completely overwhelmed. And it's not that... And I think a lot of breweries, I'm not going to say every brewery, but a lot of breweries feel like hamstrung, that they have to come up with something new in order to keep their sales going, because it has to be new. You have to have a new beer. And that's why people are starting to complain about, this is the same beer, but the hops are just put in a different order, you know?
Well, and I feel like the same is also true for the breweries that are almost like succumbing to the distributors in a way, where they're saying, you know what, you're right. I do have to only give you a couple of brands to execute on because I need the volume in order to sustain my business. They're handcuffed in a way.
All right,
well. And so they buy into that philosophy and they go out and they do it. But wasn't the thing that built craft in the early years, in the early part of this decade, wasn't it all of the exploration and all those fun things that we discovered at the retail chains? At least for me it was.
Yeah, I'd say the curated bars is where I personally, and the curated shop. But what were you going to say?
Well, devil's advocate, you know.
Not you? From you.
Yes.
Are you going to say something that's contrarian?
A little bit, right? So, Chris, I hear you. I hear that, I know everyone, no one likes to have the same beer twice. But what if they did?
Let's get over that.
What if they did? You know, what if all the breweries concentrated on just two or three beers? What if they tweaked those beers to the point where they were made not just well, but as perfect as they could possibly be made? Would that not be maybe better beer? Would that maybe be better for the consumer in the long run? Would it
in
maybe
the long
be better,
run, I think is the key.
You know, period. So, not and I'm not saying, run. I'm not blaming anyone for wanting variety, right? But marketing and branding and breweries that do such things are the ones that sort of, you know, lead the consumer to the trough. And I would like to see more breweries, and there's a few out there doing it, not succumbing to the quick, easy sale of, we've got a new DDH, we've got a new, beer, a new whatever every
whatever's
week.
It doesn't matter what it is, whatever's popular.
And
or whatever.
Saying, you know what, we're going to make this beer till it's perfect, and we think it's, you know, a really, really, really great beer. And so, we're going to shove this down your throats until y'all, you know, finally go, hey, this is a great beer. I can drink this all the time. And know what it tastes like and know that it's quality and know that it's, you know, fresh and know all the rest of it. And start tweaking those aspects of this beer business that, quite frankly, this insatiable appetite for the new beer is, in my opinion, bad for beer.
What are you going to say, Chris?
So replace my phraseology of exploration with the word education, right? Because that's what we all did. We all we self-educated on beer. We learned about stouts and porters and IPAs and Belgian styles and sours, and that's what we did. So exploration was a way of educating ourselves. And I'm not sure that the consumer today is all that interested in educating themselves about all these different types of beers, which probably, you know, gets us back to, well, why is White Claw so popular? Because it's alcohol. It's easy drinking alcohol that nobody has to think about.
It also got too complicated. You know, they wind it up. So, you know, when I was, you know, in the learning about beer a long time ago, I don't want to say when, I could actually learn every beer style, and I could learn almost every, you know, certainly.
You could try every beer style.
I could know 80% of the breweries in the world. Yeah. You know. Obviously that's not at all possible today. And, but has it been beneficial that I can't even though it's my job, I can't keep up with the breweries within 20 miles of my restaurant. In some ways it's great. And in other ways it's like, you know, I think maybe were saturated. And maybe the bubble has burst. Again, I'm saying it again.
For sure the bubble burst. We're living in the frothy aftermath of the giant bubble bursting, and we're all flailing around in these little particles amidst these bubbles. But speaking about, like, the in terms of the diversity of beer, the number of SKUs, or the new, you know, even as a small brewery, you know, we often came out with one or two different beers a week, Pat. And we also recognized...
Was that tiresome?
Well, actually, we there's a lot more beers we like to make. There's a lot of more experimentation that we like to go forward with, actually. But we also realize that we have four or five core beers that we want people to have all the time. I think for the small producer to have those four or five flagship or whatever core beers and keeping up with production of that, it can be difficult to keep on the shelves at those stores or the limited shelf space.
It's harder to do both.
Also come up with a new beer every week. But I'd also argue that even shrink or the shelf space is shrinking, and that the distributors themselves only want to deal with X amount of SKUs because they're sick of dealing with all the new.
Yeah, but I mean, in fairness, the distributors are dealing with more SKUs than in the history of distribution.
Right, and they want to cut it down.
You know, it's not like
200,000 SKUs.
Right. Yeah. I mean, they're basically kind of saying this is enough, and
it's for sure happening that it's enough because a lot of distributors are actually killing breweries. A lot of distributors aren't really selling small breweries beers anymore because A, they're not perfecting those beers. They're not beers that everybody wants. No one cares that you threw out another beer. It doesn't really matter if you make another beer if you're in a brewery that no one gives a crap about, right?
Well, the other thing is if you have to pare down to two or three beers, every brewery seems to be saying, well, I guess we'll do our IPAs.
Telling anyone to do anything or that they have to do this or they have to do that. Everyone thinks this enormous variety of beer is good for beer overall. And I'm just suggesting that maybe it isn't producing the best beer.
I want to talk to a couple things, and one of them is what Chris was talking about with education and do the consumers want to be educated now. The first part that I wanted to talk about was there was a small brewery owner who is has a very well-liked brand within the hobbyist community here in Chicago. And they do like little releases every week, and they don't really have a flagship. It's that kind of model. And they are now, because of the batch sizes they're making, pulling away from a good portion of the type of beers they made. You know, they made basically IPAs and stouts. And now, because stouts don't sell as fast, it's going to be essentially IPAs. And so even them at this tiny little scale, and they self-distribute, so it's nobody pushing this on
them. Everyone has now figured out who you're talking about.
Okay, well, whatever.
Yeah.
Are going to be doing more
IPAs. You mean the beers they wanted to make, they can't make, even at their very limited size.
I'm not saying they wanted to make one or the other. I did not get into how they felt about this happening. Yeah. It was just
it
was happening.
The market's driving the style of beer that they're making.
Yeah,
the market only wants their IPAs?
Their IPAs sell faster.
Have they played with Pilsner?
You can't just play with Pilsner.
The other thing
have they tried things other than IPA and stout?
Right. I mean, who knows? No,
well, they're just following the market. I mean, I'm not blaming anyone for that. I'm not blaming anyone for paying their bills and all that.
And that's the other thing that Chris was mentioning was are the consumers now interested in? In education, I do remember when I was around the same time as you, Chris, getting into it, I would go to some of my favorite beer bars, and they'd have these little books or exploration things where try all these beers and try all those beers, and it was so much based around getting a breadth of information, and it was so interesting and intriguing to me to learn about all this stuff, and that's what really, I think, fostered a love of craft beer in me, and... I'm not saying that spirit is definitely not dead because I definitely see people at my shop who still want to learn about that stuff, but people do not have the same interest now. They don't want to know about
I don't know.
Other styles.
Can we blame that on Untappd? No. I mean, that maybe, people are more obsessed with reviewing beer than learning about beer.
I think people know more about beer than they ever have.
I was going to say, like, there are different types of consumers. I mean, there was a smaller community back then in the, 2009 or 10, Chris, that when you started getting into beer and you guys were in the 90s or early 2000s.
Yeah, yeah. I'm old man Chris
here.
There weren't
that many people who were drinking that much beer. And remember that the craft beer is taking up a larger chunk of beer consumption overall over time. And you're just adding more people to it who may be more enthusiastic as opposed to wanting to learn about the beer and be like a diehard consumer of beverages like craft beer.
Yeah.
So I think you have a lot of different types.
We're all on a beer podcast, for crying out loud. People, according to Chris, actually listen to this. So I think people are interested in beer and interested in education of beer, certainly much more than they were when I jumped into this.
However, the bubble has burst.
More people. Yeah.
Thank you.
For sure. And I think we were talking about this. I think we were all talking about
it
bursting, right? And I'll always remember Doug Velicki saying that this is the year. This year, 2019, is the year of the long knives, and he's turned out to be completely correct.
I'm surprised.
Right? He's
when
always
is that guy.
He's always right.
Just listen to whatever he says. He's always right.
The beer cruncher.
Explain that.
Always,
the year of the long knives.
Well, I just made up my own metaphor for it, but this was the year where a lot of different changes would happen in the craft beer community in terms of the growth numbers, how far the regionals would go, I'm sure more sales, just a lot of the crazy stuff that we've seen happening here in Chicago, for example.
Competition, man. Yeah, I mean, it used to be
lots of craft
versus the macros, and now it's
craft versus craft. Yeah.
Yeah.
In some instances.
That was Chris and I talked at the Craft Brewers Conference. That was the whole point of the keynote address or whatever that was to the brewers. It was that. It was, y'all fist fighting in the streets now.
Yeah, and I got to admit, like, even when I went to this CBC and I would always see these keynote things, and I go to some of these lectures and these presentations, and I always thought it was just so generic and such low-level, unadvanced information every time I went. I felt like, man, these guys are like – this is like the most dull, boring stuff I've ever heard. But in retrospect, that dull, boring, non-exciting, not thinking in the future or experimental or being avant-garde is precisely what most businesses want to hear, right? So a person like me who sees being involved in the industry as a part of being involved in our culture here in Chicago and helping using craft beer as a way of fomenting and enabling more small manufacturing and developing more jobs and more community, beer as a vehicle for so many different things besides just tasting great. For other people, like these regionals and like all the breweries you probably talked about before I got here, it was purely a business. They wanted to make X amount of barrels per year. They wanted to grow. They saw this as a trend. These are people who are like serial entrepreneurs who see trends, jump on them, and invest in them to get money out of it. And I never approached it that way, never understood this kind of baseline baloney I would see at these conferences.
Well, that's why you're poor, Ed.
Well, yeah.
To be fair, that's always felt like a pretty small percentage of the industry to me. I mean, it's there. Like, the built to sell is there. St. Archer, built to sell, they sold to Miller. Golden Road, built to sell, they sold to AB. But, you know,
how many were built to sell and didn't sell?
Right. Yeah. Oh, no, plenty. But not that many. Like, Hopewell, Pipeworks, Half
Revolution.
Acre, even Revolution is big, but those feel like authentic brands to me.
Four out of 250 breweries.
Well, let's keep going.
And I would agree that those breweries probably don't have that. Maybe we don't know if they do or not, but we know that now they can't sell anyways, even if they had a desire.
Yeah, I was going to say.
That's the thing.
Even if they had a desire to sell, so now it is this hunkering down period.
Do you guys think there's going to be more like ABs and Millers buying American craft breweries after this?
Well, AB just has bought a bunch since August, basically.
Let me. I think
Sorry,
it's time
Chris.
That we take a break.
CBA.
Yeah.
CBA.
Yep. CBA and that brewery
you called
in
it,
Ohio.
And we have to say, you called it, Chris. Mm-hmm.
It only took two tries, but I called it.
Right.
You really did, didn't you?
Yeah, you did.
Yeah.
It's. I think you called it on this show. And I think we should take a music break. And Chris, are you going to bow out at this point?
You sticking around?
I'm here now. I mean, what do I got, another half an hour?
Come on, Chris.
Yeah.
Let's hang, buddy.
I knew we'd do it. Okay.
I want to remember the time that we met in that lobby in Portland. Maybe we're at Sassy's together.
I appreciate that, Chris. We'll come back in a few minutes after hearing some tunes with more of the Beer Temple Insiders Roundtable.
You guys already talk about the fucking Kings and Queens?
I think that's the only thing we've talked about. I'm gonna keep drinking until I'm petrified, and then maybe these tears will leave my eyes. There's a tear in my beard.
Welcome back to the Beer Temple Insiders Roundtable. I'm your host, Chris Quinn, and I'm joined by Chris Furnari, Pat Berger, Ed Marr, and Josh Noel. And I have here something that I'm doing a bit of. So I was given this beer in my hand. We'll get to the topics, but the beer in my hand, Ed.
Yes, sir.
I called this the greatest beer that Half Acre has ever made.
What is that beer?
This is their barrel-aged Baltic porter called Vim, and I was talking to Lee, who this is his beer. He's the
beautiful
barrel guy there.
About, good work, Lee.
I said, this is the only beer that Ed and I have ever fought over at the end of a show because we loved it so much.
Yep.
There's always so much beer, so much amazing beer.
Mm-hmm.
It's
empty.
Equitable.
Is that empty?
No, it's a full beer. He brought me a can. Okay, because I told him.
Wait a second.
He and I were arguing.
He knows that I also like the beer, and he brought one can.
You're getting something because you took it.
I took it. Yeah.
And he said,
"It's your replacement beer."
He said, "Here's the beer, Chris. I have one caveat. You have to have it with Ed, and Ed is not allowed to have any."
Oh.
So here you go. This
love you, Lee.
You. He said, "Anybody else in the room can have as much as they want."
All right, Lee.
Ed is allowed to have none.
Okay, Lee.
It's not me. But
all right, Lee.
I'm honoring your wishes.
That looks pretty good.
This is
while we're on the subject
of
Half Acre,
favorite Half Acre beer of all time.
Wow.
Vim.
That's
Barrel Aged Baltic Porter.
Oh yeah, speaking of Half Acre.
I'm going to take Ed's portion.
Did you talk about
there you go, Pat.
Wait a second.
Skip it.
What? Did you talk about what's going on at Half Acre?
No, but I do think so. You're talking about what happened today?
Let's get to that.
Oh, okay.
Later.
Sure.
I don't think we have to talk about it. It speaks to what's going on in the business.
I think it speaks to what's going on. Why don't you explain it, Ed? Why are you intrigued?
Well, you know, I'm really excited because Half Acre is partnering up with One Off Hospitality, who's pioneered awesome dining in Chicago with their first restaurant, which was Blackbird. Their numerous James Beard Award-winning restaurants and chefs and even owners are feted for being the best hospitality people on earth. They have the Publican, you know, Big Star,
which is the news today.
Is that they're going to work. Half Acre is going to work with Big Star. Big Star is going to be taking over the kitchen over at their Balmoral facility, which is their main production brewery.
Right.
Up on the north side.
So Half Acre had their own food program in that kitchen when they opened the tap room 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. By the way, where did you read this article today?
I read it in the Chicago Tribune.
Oh, very nice.
Yeah.
So Half Acre ran their own food program with a very well-regarded chef mm-hmm. for a couple of years.
The food there, when it first opened, was exceptional. I thought it was like Bib Gourmand level. It was so good. It was absolutely amazing.
Harissa Salmon, baby.
Yeah, he left.
Yes, he did. He got a big time job too.
Okay.
So the chef left, and then Half Acre was sort of at this intersection of what do we do with our kitchen? What do we do with our food program? Do we hire a new chef and sort of keep that vision going? And they pivoted hard and decided to team up with the cool hipster taco brand in town. Tacos,
yep.
Guac,
mm-hmm.
The food is good at Big Star, I think it's mm-hmm. fair to say.
Mm-hmm.
And they've wrapped it in a sort of a hipster aesthetic of whiskey and craft beer and vinyl.
Margaritas.
And some really good cocktails. And Pappy, like they've got Pappy Van Winkle sitting behind the bar. They're that place. And Half Acre decided to fold in with them and let Big Star take it over. And Well, you talk first, Ed. Why do you think it's reflective of what's happening?
But because I agree with you. You want to differentiate yourself in the marketplace, and there's 200 breweries with on-premise drinking and tap rooms that you can go to with food or without food. The majority of places probably prefer having food. And as Pat will attest, it's really difficult to do food. Breweries do beer great. They might not necessarily be the best hospitality industry people on earth. And it's pretty hard to do really great food on the scale of like a whatever Band of Bohemia or Rick Bayless's place, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm assuming, and I haven't talked to Gabriel or Matt about it, and I look forward to talking to him about it, but I'm excited for him. You're working with some really great pro people who are basically the meter for all hospitality business in the city of Chicago, if not the rest of the country. Their service, the quality of their food, the way they could scale it, and the way they present it's going to be awesome. It takes away some expense from Half Acre to deal with the food program and the additional employees. I'm not sure what the deal is, but I'm presuming Big Star is keeping all the food money.
They're doing a split.
It's great. Even better.
And both ways? And Half Acre, split both ways?
You mean
so Big Star gets booze money?
No, I recall that the split is on the kitchen.
Yeah, they're probably doing a split in the kitchen where they don't pay rent. They just get a percentage of all food. Great. That's the way to do it.
And it's interesting that I think what we're going to see, I think this question was sort of raised earlier, is like, are we going to see more of this Kings and Convicts Ballast Point stuff? Are we going to see, you know, what's going to happen going forward? I think we're just going to see a lot of creative solutions and partnerships and breweries folding in together. And it wouldn't surprise me if one-off bought, I'm not going to say Half Acre, but a Chicago brewery one day.
I think they always thought about doing a brewery, doing a brew pub, and they probably realized it was not worth doing.
I think, Chris, I'd like to bring it back a little bit further than just a specific Chicago-based brewery. I think now breweries and certainly breweries that are on-premise with their on-premise focus, it's a concept now. And it's becoming more of like a restaurant, you know? I mean, we're bringing these guys in to do our food. These people are going to do our beer. And it sounds to me like how different groups of people come together and put together a space.
Yeah.
The difference is Half Acre also has a very big production facility as well.
Yeah.
But this is just like, you know, it's
you need more reasons.
Tap rooms
to come.
Are concepts
you need
now.
More, you need more
instead
reasons
of an Irish bar,
to,
it's a tap room.
You need more reasons to go to the tap room than just try the 12 beers on draft. You need some food there.
Yeah, I totally agree. I mean, it's really sort of like the next evolution of like having a food truck at a brewery, right? Like, yeah, that was cool for a while, but if you want people to stay and you want to be more than just a brewery with a food truck and you want that food component and that's not your area of expertise, well, it makes complete sense to bring in an operator like the folks from Big Star. they've done a great job for years. I remember going eating tacos there years ago. I'm seeing this in Boston. I'm talking to folks here locally that are, you know, looking at their opportunities in this, you know, sort of area where, hey, can we bring in a cool regional, whether it's like a regional type of food, you know, like a specialty food from that area or a cool concept or a cool restaurant group that's really making waves. Can we partner up with them and bring them into either our new brew pub location or our new taproom location that we're going to open up or our existing brewery? I think people are really opening themselves up to those opportunities now.
And this reminds me a little bit of what you were saying, Pat, before, is how it's all – I don't want to mess your words up, but you were saying something about it's all about marketing and branding and stuff like that. And do you think that this is just like kind of, well, your brand's strong, my brand's strong, let's go for it. I mean, there's a lot of people who make really good food, right?
They got to have, the brands have to have a similar vibe.
Yeah.
And also prestige or cultural capital to pair up like that, right?
I think if you look at it from each one of their perspectives, why does it make sense for Half Acre? You know, as Ed said, they're beer people. They'd probably rather concentrate on the beer, right? So it makes sense to sort of, you know, put that whole food category into someone who's incredibly adept at it, which one-off is. And then for one-off, why would you, you know, instead of opening up another location somewhere else, why would you go into Half Acre? Well, the overhead is probably nothing because the kitchen was there.
Yep.
The space
and
is there.
The audience is there.
Yeah. You're spending $0 on renovations. You kind of have an idea already of what business is like. You know, obviously you feel you can increase it, but you have an idea. I mean, there's a lot of
and you can only own so much of Milwaukee North Damon, the crotch.
Well, you know, I mean, opening another restaurant in Chicago right now, I can't speak for the rest of the country, just here, is not something I would recommend. And this is kind of a low risk, low overhead way to expand your empire. Yeah, I think it makes a lot of sense.
It's sort of a safe approach for both brands, and I think the broader point is we're going to see more versions of this.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, this is a classic like 1+1=3 scenario.
Yeah.
And people were, you know, just on social media, people seemed pretty fired up about it. I mean, of course, there were the 10% naysayers.
How far north is that? 4800 north? 5200 north?
Yeah, it's far.
You don't have to go to Liquor Park or downtown or West Loop to get the food. You could just stay on the north side. If you're in Evanston, it might be a little 15-minute ride.
There's one in Wrigleyville.
Yeah,
one in Wrigleyville. But no one goes to Wrigleyville.
Yeah, no one wants to go to Ricketts.
Yeah, it's too crowded.
Who wants to go to
Wrigleyville? No one goes there. It's too crowded.
But who wants to go there? Have you been to Wrigleyville? Have you been there?
No, I've heard about
it. And you live close to it. You don't even go there, do you?
Yeah.
You don't even get bad sushi in Wrigleyville, do you?
No, I don't.
See?
I don't.
See?
No. I go with my kids whenever there's some sort of thing at Wrigley.
So the gourmand or the enthusiastic wannabe gourmand will not have to go to Wrigleyville. They could go to Balmoral.
Have you guys talked about, I'm going completely off script here. Have you guys talked about the new Moody Tongue concept on this program?
Now that's something interesting because they just opened, right? And they have a tasting menu.
$150.
Well, and all in with... You prepay, so you reserve, you buy your ticket online ahead of time with tip, with tax, blah, blah, blah. It comes out to about $210. 12 courses.
Woof.
12 courses.
It's pretty cheap for 12 courses, to be honest with you.
It is.
With the beer included.
Yeah.
And a Michelin-starred chef. I mean, like, this is the guy who made Longman and Eagle and made Deucex. It's like, it's not some fly-by-night operation.
He's no slouch.
Yeah. But still, it is... A 12-course beer pairing menu. I think you get 14 beers across the 12 courses. $200. It's a bold move.
Bold.
It is bold. But it's, you know, people moaning about the price, I think, aren't familiar with
tasting
menus. Dining.
Yeah.
Yeah. But also, you know, what's risky for them, I think, in this endeavor is that it is in the location that Batterbrow was in, right? And that's a very tough location right off the highway by McCormick Place.
No question.
It's worse than being in Bridgeport.
Is fine dining, I don't want to say immune, but more immune to that because it's such a destination?
I think so, yes. That's what I was going to say. If you are providing something that people can't, you know, stop talking about, it doesn't matter where you're at. I mean, you know.
And that's I haven't heard much buzz about it since it opened, honestly, but... You know,
how
I
long
mean,
has it
a,
been?
A $200 experience might not be, you know.
Well, they're going to
have a natural buzz generator.
Yeah, they're going to have the major reviews come out probably in the next, you know, before the end of the year.
Yes,
and that's,
they will.
That'll make and break them. I mean, it's a whole nother animal, fine dining, and it's risky wherever you do it. I think,
especially in this kind of Grubhub. Everybody wants to order food
just
at home age.
Anytime.
Right?
Anytime. You have to absolutely nail it, and you have to get Michelin stars. If you don't have Michelin stars, you will not succeed in this.
Yeah, it seems very much like it's built on that. Yeah. And if that happens, Chicago
if that happens, they're set,
the nation's only two Michelin-starred brew pubs.
Yep.
If they get one or two Michelin stars, I think they'll do just fine.
Well, they'll just invite Darren Revelle over to put it on his Instagram.
They are buddies with
Twitter.
Darren Revelle. Did you know that?
I am, yeah. Okay. Or I do know that.
Chris Furnari knows what's up, ladies and gentlemen.
he's always chirping about Moody Tongue.
Is he?
Yeah.
One of those social influencers.
That is correct.
I plan on checking it out.
Me too.
You're going to open the wallet for the $200 experience?
I mean, for a date night, that's
And for the two of you, it's $400.
I've spent more, man.
Pat and I switch off when we go out, and but you know, it's your turn next, Pat.
You take the wife out for an anniversary or a birthday or something. That's not that bad.
Now, I think it's ambitious. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, what did you feel about? Can we talk a little bit about Bourbon County? I mean, I think it's certainly a bigger deal here.
I thought we were going to get through this without it, but
come on.
I know. Would you, Josh, here?
Let's do a quick vote.
Impossible.
Should we talk about hard seltzer and White Claw, or should we talk about Bourbon County?
Or
let's
more,
do a quick vote.
Or more just
industry stuff.
Isn't that
stuff? Like the same choice? All right.
I'll take Bourbon County.
I vote for Anderson Valley.
Anderson Valley.
Yeah, I'm down for Anderson Valley.
Talk about Anderson Valley real quick. How about that?
Let's
do 5 minutes on Anderson Valley.
Let's do it. Go, Chris.
I may have something to say in the future weeks about Bourbon County. If you will have me back on your show, there might be more interesting things to say. Yeah, perhaps.
Let's talk about Anderson Valley, Chris.
Set it up.
Yes. I mean, I guess my sort of big takeaway here is that, this is the second time in the last decade that this company has changed hands. And I think, I don't know if we were talking about this off air or on air, but it was kind of like a, changing of the brewery to just another guy from the local area, right? Like a local investor.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we're going to see some more of that. Like people buy wineries, people might just start buying breweries if it makes sense.
We don't know the sale price on that, do we, Chris?
I have no idea.
Do we know how many barrels they do?
They won't have to disclose that. That's a private sale between.
Right.
And Anderson Valley doesn't disclose their information to.
Yeah, they don't even disclose their barrelage.
Yeah, they don't. You'll never know
how much they paid for that.
They peaked around like 50,000 barrels, and they say that they're in the top 100 craft breweries. So actually, the boilerplate says they're in the top 75. They say top 100. So. And they faced some declines in recent years, but
right, so they sold for $40-50 million.
Oh, I think that would be high,
High, I think. If Ballast Point went for 75,
well, Ballast Point is.
Wait a minute, Ballast Point went for 75. Well,
we don't know that for sure. Chris is semi reporting that.
Now
here
will
on
we
the show.
Will we get a hard?
I've heard 70 to 80 million.
Chris, you could probably answer this. Will we get a hard number from the Ballast Point sale? Because Constellation being a public company,
yeah.
They'll have
so
to.
No, they don't have to.
I think it depends upon how much the deal is worth, right? So if it triggers a review, then I'm not entirely clear on what that figure is, but if it triggers a review, then. I think they will have to disclose.
My understanding is that if the sale is material to its overall financial health, then they would need to reveal. But for instance, none of the Anheuser-Busch sales have been deemed material to Anheuser-Busch's overall health, except for the Goose Island sale, because that was, I guess, between two publicly traded companies. Probably had more to do with CBA than anything.
So that number
came out, but none of the other AB sales did. So I don't think it's a guarantee that the number will have to come out, but it may, and I'm sure Chris will be looking at the filings, and I'll be looking at the filings, and, well, let's hope it does, because that would sure be some fun fodder to chat over.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if we saw something in a filing. That was the first thing I did when I saw the press release, actually. I was like, oh, well, there's got to be a filing on this. They're public. So I went straight to the... look for the 8K or whatever it is there, the 10Q or whatever they file, and it wasn't there. So there could be something in the coming days. And I've heard that if there is a review process, like a federal review process, that there might be some sort of disclosure that they need to make.
So does this mean that if we're in this bubble, and then the last housing bubble crisis? You had all kinds of investment firms purchasing up random apartment buildings and foreclosed buildings and all over the country. Like, who's that awesome investor guy out west who's a Democrat supporting dude who's super is a billionaire? You don't know? Anyways.
Bloomberg?
No. Another one. Know. But does this mean that...
I'm just
mean,
a restaurateur. I'm not an
is
economist.
Is this now the time to pick that. Up? Is this now the time to buy breweries all over the place? I mean, are people willing to sell and get out of this incredibly difficult business? I mean, do you think it might be a... You might be getting a brewery for pennies on the dollar?
It may be starting, mm-hmm. I think. But I think this is going to be a long story, and it's going to be unfolding for a while. Because mm-hmm. a lot of these brewery owners have started in the last 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
They're still relatively young. But in another, you know, over the next 20 years, what's going to happen? I think, there's going to be some of that, sure. Yeah. I mean, what you own a brewery? What do you think?
Well, there's still more breweries opening up in Chicago, right? But I think I've also heard of breweries closing all over the place, and friends I have are actually picking up brewing equipment, even the businesses themselves, and purchasing them for a pretty significant discount.
Yeah, this is always a good indicator. How's that going? Because it used to be like, you know, like let's say 2001, 2002, you could get a brewery for, you know, 5-10 cents on the dollar, and then used equipment, you know, during the boom was almost more expensive than new equipment because you could get it immediately.
Mm-hmm.
Where are we at now, Ed?
You still have to wait for your equipment. There still is a backlog.
But
prices
how about
haven't
used?
Really gone. Used, I mean, it hasn't gone down that much unless you have to sell your whole kit and caboodle or you're liquidating or you're going bankrupt. But, you know, I don't look for a lot of used equipment myself. But there's a lot more used equipment for sale. For sure. I get notifications from different sites.
Okay.
But
when that drops to, like, you know, 10 cents on the
dollar.
It's
time for us to make milk. It's now you'll be using brewing equipment to actually pasteurize milk.
It's time for me to buy a brewery.
It'll come full circle.
Yeah. I just have a few minutes left, so let me ask. I got to do it. Bourbon County.
Oh,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, bring it up.
So you got all your stuff early, right?
I did. I got a source who... Well, it went in two stages. I did a Twitter plea and got some guys to sell me their bottles and sit down with me, and that was pretty fun. And then for the second round, I hooked up with a source who shall not be named, who connected me with some bottles.
One of the brewers at the Goose Island, I hope.
Possibly.
All right,
possibly, but I'm not saying anymore.
So anyway, do you think you're going to do it next year as well? Do you, owe it to your people, to your listeners?
You know what? I'm going to reward myself by not thinking about it.
Okay.
For a year. I hope Goose Island just invites me next year and does the right thing and just this doesn't need to be an issue, and it didn't need to be an issue the first time.
Well, let's tell everyone what the issue is, because I think some of our listeners out there don't know what the issue is.
I feel like everyone knows what the issue is. But
Josh,
that's because you're so self-centered.
No, I have deliberately not been self-centered and said to a bunch of people, like, so do you know about how I didn't get invited to Bourbon County? And they're like, does anyone not know? So I sort of stopped prefacing it at this point.
Some people don't know.
You're right.
There's a guy in Pilsen right now.
All right. Do we have time for this even?
Quickly.
So Goose Island does Bourbon County tasting every year for the media. I've gone every year as, you know, the representative of the local paper of record. This year they did not invite me. I asked them. I said, well, okay, can I come though? And they said, no, we're not comfortable with you being there. I said, well, what does that mean? Explain that to me. Because I was actually open-minded to maybe there was a good reason for it. And if there was, then I was going to say, you know, okay, so give me the bottles as media samples, and I'll just taste them on my own, and I don't need to go to your tasting. That's fine. They said, well, we're not going to do that either. And then I said, why am I not invited to this tasting that all these other media people are going to be going to and their coverage is going to be coming out of? And then at that point, they pivoted to, well, every year there's a very limited number of seats, and we have to make difficult decisions about who to invite and so forth, which was completely insincere. And so I was left to sort of figure out how to review Bourbon County, which is, you know, in some ways it's a flagging brand a little bit, but it also still retains a lot of cultural power. And it was, you know, it's important to the Tribune readership to write about it. So I figured out how to write about it in two installments.
I will say this,
Josh.
What's
Josh,
up, Chris?
Can I ask a question?
Please.
Were you dealing with Anheuser-Busch PR representatives or third-party representatives for these conversations.
Right. So Goose Island and AB have PR agencies. I'm not saying that to you, Chris. I'm explaining it to the audience. So that's what Chris is asking. Was I dealing with basically a PR agency or directly with the company? I was dealing with an Anheuser-Busch PR person who is communicating directly with Goose Island. So I do believe, I'm quite certain of it, that this originated out of Goose Island rather than originated out of
Anheuser-Busch. I want to see the transcripts of the Ukrainian PR person working with ABF.
Running out of time. I will say, I will be on
Anheuser-Busch, if you're listening.
Yeah, yeah, that's lame.
They're not.
It was the most interesting and different from any previous year retail release on Black Friday that there's ever been. I'll leave it at that.
Did you have a line?
As a cliffhanger. Yeah.
How was your allocation?
It was fine.
Yeah.
Enough.
Yeah.
There was enough of, well, not enough of what people wanted and plenty of a lot of stuff, and you know, it's
sounds like the typical deal.
Yeah. It was interesting. We can talk about it off air, maybe, and maybe come back and talk about it.
I actually appreciated when you guys talked about it a few weeks ago. It led the show a few weeks ago, and I was listening live. I thought I appreciated the conversation, especially Doug Velicki, who we mentioned before. His perspective actually helped me understand it a little bit better.
So, yeah. Well, thanks, Doug. Second shout out for Doug. His head will get just a little bit bigger. I want to thank my guests, Chris and Pat and Ed and Josh. I want to thank producer Annie and everyone out there listening. Any final words, everybody?
I have a call to action. No, I'm just kidding.
I'm just going to drop a big F-bomb.
Yeah, just go start dropping F-bombs,
yeah.
Ed.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you, guys. We'll see
you
next week.
Thanks, guys.
Bye.
Thanks,
later,
guys.
Chris.
Appreciate the time.
Yeah, man.
Never be heard or seen from again, 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 again. Remember, this is what we wanted. Remember, this is what we said. To never be heard or seen from again, 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 again. Remember, this is what we wanted. Remember, this is what we said. To never be heard or seen from again, again, again.